AKS Automatic is going to make your life easier. My name is Paul Yu, and I am a Cloud Native Developer Advocate here at Microsoft. And in this episode of a six-part series, we'll explore how AKS Automatic improves your security posture out of the box. There's loads of features that I want to show you, so let's go. When it comes to securing your cluster, you need to think about both cluster security, like who's accessing the cluster, upgrading and patching the cluster, and making sure folks don't do anything intentionally or accidentally to the underlying cloud infrastructure. Then you also need to think about workload security. Are you deploying your manifests, following the best practices? How are you managing app configs, secrets? Many of the features I'm gonna show you aren't new. They've always been available in AKS. The only difference here is that they're deployed for you as soon as your AKS Automatic clusters provision. Let's start with cluster security. The first thing you're going to notice if you head over to the cluster configuration is that authentication and authorization is set to Microsoft Entra authentication with Azure RBAC. You'll also notice, and here's what I like to do anytime I look at an Azure resource, sometimes the UI doesn't have all the features. So what I like to do is I like to head over to the resource, in this case, the AKS Automatic Cluster, and I'll hit the JSON view button. What I'll do from there is I'll choose the latest and greatest API. And then inside of this JSON, I can look for things like local, because I want to show you that the local account has been disabled. So this is actually set to true. And if you also look for things like AAD profile, you can see here that Azure RBAC is enabled. By default, all Kubernetes needs to access this API is a valid certificate. This isn't auditable, and it makes it difficult to revoke once a user has access to your kubeconfig file. So it is recommended that you disable this and use service principles and kube login instead. Let me show you what that looks like. So what I can do is I can do an az aks get credentials, and I can pull down the kubeconfig, but just having the kubeconfig isn't enough. So now if I do a kubectl get nodes or any kubectl command, I'm gonna be challenged with an authentication prompt. Now, I do need to have kube login installed, and if you don't already have it installed, you can actually install it using an az aks command. So you can do a az aks install CLI, and this command will actually install it for you. So let's take a look at what happens when you do a kubectl get nodes. So you can see here that I got challenged by Microsoft Entra, and it's asking me to do a device code login. And so I can actually just copy that code here and then head over to this URL. So I'll just go microsoft.com device login, and it's gonna ask me for the code. So I paste that code in, and then I'll just need to authenticate and MFA. So once I've successfully logged in, if I go back to my terminal, you can see that the kubectl command is actually completed, and now I can run any kubectl command. So this is a great way to configure security for your cluster, all while using Azure RBAC. And check this out. You may have not noticed this, but in the Azure portal, when you set up your AKS cluster, you're actually given a role assignment. And I talked about that in when we were doing the Terraform stuff. But if you go over here and you click check my access for the cluster, you can see that I have the Kubernetes service RBAC admin command. This lets me to do anything inside of the Kubernetes API. And while we're looking at nodes, let's see what the system node pool is running. So underneath the covers, the system node pool is actually running Azure Linux. Azure Linux is the default OS for the AKS system node pool, and it's Microsoft's Linux distribution that focuses on security with kernel level isolation and confidential computing. So if I'm looking at my nodes here, and if I run the kubectl node command, but this time, just take a look at some of the metadata that's inside of the node info, I can actually see that they are actually running CBL Mariner Linux. For those of you that don't know, this is actually the code name for Azure Linux. And just to continue on with node security, let me show you how SSH is actually disabled on all the nodes as well. So when you disable SSH, it actually reduces the attack vector, as users will no longer be able to directly access your nodes and pods via SSH. So if I just flip over to the Azure portal here, and if I just jump back over into the JSON view of my cluster, and if I search inside here for SSH, there we go. You can see that in my security profile, I actually have SSH disabled. But if for any reason you actually need to get into the nodes, you can always continue to run the kubectl debug node command because that doesn't rely on SSH, so you can continue to use that. The other cluster related feature that I wanted to touch on is automatic upgrades. So with AKS Automatic, the goal is to basically streamline your cluster operations. And we can do this by ensuring that both Kubernetes and node images are kept up to date and on a schedule of your choice. Let's take a look at that. So if I head back over to my AKS cluster, and if I go down into the cluster configuration, you can see here that the Kubernetes version upgrade type is set to stable. So every single stable release of Kubernetes, your Kubernetes cluster will automatically upgrade itself. And in terms of node OS image patching, we have this set on a schedule as well. So here we configured it, or actually we just left it at the defaults when we spun up the cluster. So right now it's set to patch the OS images every Sunday at midnight. So that'll hopefully streamline your cluster operations. And if you need to change this, you can always change this by coming into the edit schedule and setting this to whatever schedule that suits you best. One last thing that I wanted to touch on when it comes to cluster security is the whole concept of node resource group lockdown. You see, when an AKS cluster is provisioned, a lot of the underlying Azure infrastructure is provisioned in a separate resource group. Now, most often you don't want to mess with anything in this resource group, right? And so with AKS Automatic, AKS Automatic will actually place a lock on that resource group, so you can't do anything with it. Let me show you that in action. So if I head over to the AKS portal and I scroll down to properties, and if I click on the resource group here, it'll take me to that resource group. And then from there, what I can do is I can actually try to delete it and go ahead and push that and say that we want to delete it. And then immediately I get a notification that access is denied because of NRG lockdown or node resource group lockdown. So this is a great way to help you prevent either intentional or unintentional tampering with resources in this particular resource group. All right, so now let's move into some workload related security features that's available to you. So as you deploy workloads into your cluster, obviously you're gonna have configuration and you're gonna have secrets. Now with Azure Kubernetes Service, the Azure Key Vault provider is installed by default. So it's actually ready for you to start integrating secrets from, let's say, an Azure Key Vault and have those secrets projected into your cluster. And you can see that by just going over into the workloads section here. And if I click on pods, and then if I scroll down, you can see here that I have AKS Secret Store CSI driver and AKS Secret Store provider inside of my cluster. So what these will essentially allow me to do is create manifests of the Secret Store provider class, which will enable me to integrate with an Azure Key Vault and pull in secrets or certificates into my cluster. The other bit of workload security is AKS Image Cleaner add-on. Now, this add-on is actually based on the open source Eraser project, and it's actually designed to remove unused or vulnerable images cached on the node. So typically Kubernetes will only trigger a cache cleanup once disk space reaches a certain threshold. Having this add-in in place in your cluster will ensure that nothing is left on the cluster that could be used against you. That could be vulnerable images or images that are just sitting around on the system. And you might have noticed that in the deployment blade here, you might have noticed that there is a eraser controller manager here. And so this is the operator that's actually basically sweeping through your cluster, making sure it removes any unused or vulnerable images. And you can actually see some of the configuration here. So if I go and click on the Kubernetes or kubesystem namespace, you will find there's an eraser manager config. And if I take a look at the YAML here, you can see that it's actually based on Trivy scans, and it's deploying this particular collector. And then down here, it basically looks for any particular vulnerabilities. So it'll look at OS vulnerabilities, library vulnerabilities, and it'll clean out anything with these specific severities. So it's a pretty neat way to ensure that your cluster stays clean. and there isn't really anything that you need to do. Just know that the operator is in there and it's working to clean things up. So one other cool feature that I wanted to highlight here is the whole notion of workload identity. Workload identity on AKS will enable you to assign identities, which are going to be Azure user assigned managed identities, to your pods. So for the workloads that are running in your cluster, your pods can then use these identities to authenticate to other Azure services. And that's all enabled in your cluster out the gate. Typically, you'd have to turn that on yourself. But if you go here into the JSON view again, and if you search for workload identity, you can see that the workload identity feature is enabled. And in order for that to work, you also need to have the OIDC issuer profile enabled. So workload identity enables you to leverage a Kubernetes construct, which is Kubernetes service account token volume projection. And that enables you to have service accounts, assign them to pods, and when authentication requests are made, these tokens can be exchanged. As long as it's federated with Microsoft Entra, they can be exchanged for bearer tokens so that you can have access to other Azure resources. And I would also note that there is a great video on the AKS community channel by Steve Griffith on AKS workload identity, so I highly encourage you to go check that out. And the one last thing that I want to call out here, and it's a pretty cool feature of AKS, is the whole notion of deployment safeguards. And you can see on my screen here, it's actually right underneath the OIDC issuer profile. So basically, deployment safeguards enforce Kubernetes best practices in your AKS cluster. And it does all this through Azure Policy integration. Azure Policy has controls with configurable levels, and these levels could be either warnings or enforcements. The warning level issues alerts for non-compliance, while enforcement actually denies deployments that do not follow best practices. And because this feature is integrated with Azure Policy, you can configure policy assignments and even view compliance across workloads all through the Azure Policy compliance dashboard. So let's go take a look at what this looks like. If I were to run a command, and you might have noticed this, so if I do kubectl run my, let's say an Nginx pod, right? There's no best practices here. I'm literally just running the container. And if I run this, you'll see immediately that I have warnings that are emitted into my terminal. And so here it's saying, hey, I should have readiness probes. Obviously I don't have that because I just did a kubectl run command. I also have an unauthenticated image pool here, because Nginx is typically available out on Docker Hub, so it's publicly accessible. It's recommended that I use authenticated pools instead. So you can see here that it's automatically telling me that, hey, I'm not following best practices here. You can also see this through the Azure portal. So if I go back to my resource group, so if I go to resources, resource group, and I go find my resource group, what I can do is I can actually go here, well, actually I can search for policy. So you can see here that I can see policy assignments for this particular resource group. And if I do a filter here, AKS, you can see it's at the top of my list, AKS safeguards. And so here you can see that I am not in compliance with my workloads. So some of the things like containers must have CPU and memory resource requests, the liveness and readiness probes, that's what we saw in the terminal. And the things about containers should only run, you know, using authenticated pools, image pool secrets. And so if I click on each one and I go into the details here, I can see which pods are in violation of this policy. So you can see I was doing a little bit of testing. So I have, I was running Node Debugger and this other thing to actually exec into one of my nodes. So these are in violation. And so you can see all that through the Azure portal, which is pretty cool. That was a whirlwind tour of security features of AKS Automatic. In the next episode, we'll explore how AKS Automatic's networking defaults and configuration is set up. So be sure to hit the like and the subscribe button. And if you want to be notified of the next video, hit the bell icon too. See you in the next one.